So all of Scripture is pointing to Jesus. All of Scripture is pointing to Jesus, and they're bearing witness about Jesus.
Welcome to the Building Faith Families podcast with Steve Demme. I'm your host, Scott Moore. Thanks for joining us today.
Good morning, Steve. How are you today?
Oh, I'm just peachy. I have to think of a new way to say this, but I did buy peaches yesterday, one of the only fresh fruits you can buy right now. My wife loves peaches, and God bless her, she's sick, and so I'm doing the grocery shopping. So I bought her some fresh peaches yesterday.
You know, I've been living on peaches and bananas since I got sick, and it stuck. Like, I started doing that because it was about the only thing I could really, enjoy. I don't know if enjoy is really the right word. It was the only thing I could eat for a little while, and I've kept doing it for breakfast since then. So, but mine are like canned peaches, weird enough. My wife never buys those because she doesn't like canned fruit, and we always had it when I was a kid. So maybe it's a comfort food for me or something. I don't know.
Now I know what to get you for your birthday.
There you go.
A case of canned peaches.
I'll take them, man.
Okay. Well, two podcasts ago, we talked about God's name, which I still can't get enough of. I just have to tell you, I am reveling in what I'm learning about God through his name. In fact, the other day, I was kind of struggling a little bit. I thought, how do I bless his name? You know, how do I praise his name? And I prayed. I asked God, what am I missing? And the first thing that God brought to my head was the beginning of the disciples' prayer. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. That's all he had to say. One sentence. And I got it. Because hallowed or holy is your name. My mind immediately ran to Isaiah chapter 6, where the angels or the living creatures were worshiping God, and they said, holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. And I made the connection. You know, God knows how to communicate with each one of us, and we're all different. But he communicated to me. All he said was, hallowed be your name. And I put it together because God's name and God's person are inseparable. So if I'm going to bless his name, I'm really blessing his person, because God's name and his person are the same. They're one. God is holy and his name is holy. But we're going to talk about today what we started to talk about last week a little bit, his word. And God's word is also the same as God himself, because God, Jesus, is the word made flesh. So God, his word, his name, they are one. And that's why we can't mess with God's word. We can't add to it. We can't take away from it, because it's a revelation of God himself. God is the word made flesh. And his name, it's why he tells us in the Ten Commandments, don't take my name in vain. Because you take my name in vain, you take me in vain. And we're supposed to be worshiping God and loving God, and he's worthy of our worship. And there's one verse that brings these two thoughts together, and it's found in Psalm 138. I give you thanks, O Yahweh, with my whole heart. Before the gods, I sing your praise. I bow down toward your holy temple and give thanks to your name for your steadfast love and your faithfulness. For you have exalted above all things your name and your word. Isn't that a powerful passage?
Wow.
Psalm 138, you have exalted above all things your name and your word. And our last podcast, we talked about our adventures, but then we ended up talking about how abiding in God's word leads to bearing fruit, But knowing God also leads to bearing fruit. The more we know God, the more fruit we're going to bear. So knowing God's name feeds into this thought. Knowing God's word is a part of bearing God's fruit. So let's pray. Father, thank you for your word that you've given to us. And I know I've been guilty of not treating it with the respect that I ought to, but yet at the same time, thank you for helping me to love your word, helping me to be faithful in reading your word. Thank you for that habit you started so many decades ago to read a portion of your word every day. And I pray that you help me to increase in my desire to not only love you, but to love your name and to love your word, because they all go together. And the more I know your name, the more I'll know you, and the more I love your word, the more I'll love you. I pray that you'll help my heart to be beating with David's heart and Paul's heart and Moses' heart, who loved God, loved his word, loved God's name. In Jesus' name, help us all to drink of that stream, of that clean water that comes from heaven, that tunes our heart, so to speak, as the song says, to sing your praise and to love the things that you love. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
So we did talk about abiding in God, loving God, and bearing fruit for God. And there's a connection. And it came because Paul had prayed for the Colossian church that they would increase in their understanding of God and they would increase in their ability to bear fruit. So I'm going to read a lot of scripture today because that's what we're going to talk about, his word. I'm going to begin with John chapter 15, first 8 verses. And you were actually the one that put me onto this. So
cool.
I don't know if you remember that a while back. He said, boy, why didn't you bring up John 15? I went, oh, yeah. Duh. So here you go. I am the true vine, and my Father is the vine dresser. Every branch in me that does not bear fruit, he takes away. And every branch that does bear fruit, he prunes, that it might bear more fruit. Already you are clean because of the word that I have spoken to you. Abide in me. And I in you, as the branch cannot bear fruit by itself unless it abides in the vine, neither can you unless you abide in me. I am the vine. You are the branches. Whoever abides in me and I in him, he it is that bears much fruit. For apart from me, you can do nothing. If anyone does not abide in me, he is thrown away like a branch and withers, and the branches are gathered, thrown into the fire, and burnt. If you abide in me, and my words abide in you, ask whatever you wish, and it will be done for you. By this my Father is glorified, that you bear much fruit, and so prove to be my disciples. And probably like yourself, when I read that passage, my first thought is, boy, how do I abide in God? I want to bear fruit for God. I want to glorify God. How do I live in him? How do I get tapped into him? Because my mind is filled with that image of a branch, part of a vine. How does the life-giving nutrients that are flowing up through that vine find their way out into my branch so that there can be fruit at the end of the branch? And I think the key at the very end, he says, my words abide in you. If you abide in me and my words abide in you. Now, we know that 3 verses later, he's going to say, abide in my love, which I've talked a lot about that. And God's helping me to do that. I'm helping to just live in the awareness and the conviction that God loves me and I love him. So I'm abiding in his love. But I want his words to abide in me. I don't know who it was that first discipled you, Scott, but how did they encourage you to read the Bible? I mean, because you were a navigator. So this is a lot of emphasis on God's word. Just curious.
What's funny is that I wasn't I was pretty resistant to the whole idea of scripture memory. And we had a small group men's Bible study my freshman year in college. And I'd started going to Navigators and then joined this Bible study. And the guy that was the Navs guy there, Ward Ballard, who was definitely the first guy who really discipled me in this regard, he challenged us all to memorize a verse a week. But he was really patient with me because I grew up in a certain background where that was probably thought of as being too, too religious or something. I don't know what the idea I had in my head was, but somehow I thought that that would be bad, which seems ridiculous now, but so I didn't do it. I didn't memorize anything, but slowly I saw the word get into these guys' lives and I saw their hearts really. They were exhibiting more of the love of Christ than I felt like I was in some ways. And I thought maybe there's something to this scripture memory stuff. And especially when you hear someone who's been doing it for years and the word just pours out of them, like, you know, with you, for instance. I mean, the word doesn't just flow out of me as easily as it does for some people, because I haven't gotten as much of it into my heart, you know, and I want more of that. So, but that was the first that I really started with that. And eventually I did start memorizing scripture, but I'm still slow at it.
And I also know, though, that now you make a habit of listening to the Bible.
Yes. Yeah, I do the Daily Audio Bible Podcast, and they go through the Bible in a year, every year listening to it. And that's been life-changing for me. First of all, I've gotten to the Bible many more times than I would have just reading it on my own, because I'm just not that disciplined about it. And I can do this while I'm driving around. So, but it's been really helpful.
Good. Well, you know, it does say in Revelation, blessed are those who read and hear the words of this prophecy. So yeah, that's legitimate. I have had pretty full summer in speaking, and when I'm on the road and banging around hotels, I'm not in a good rhythm like I am at home. You know, at home, I'm in a good rhythm. I get up and I read the word and I go through my new thing that I've been doing is based on the book, Come Into His Presence. I focus on one aspect of Jesus' character. I read a portion. I sing a hymn. I give thanks. I bless his name. And then I do my Bible reading. But I'm older. Don't have 14 kids running around the house. And so, you know, I know that that's not realistic. But I got behind this summer. Because if I don't have a schedule, I'll never finish the Bible in a year. That's my own opinion. So with this schedule, I checked and sure enough, I was behind. And so I had some long drives and I listened to Proverbs. I heard most of Proverbs. I only read a few chapters of Proverbs, most of it I listened to, and a couple Psalms, and now I'm caught up. So I'm in Ecclesiastes in my Old Testament reading, and I've got a couple more Psalms, and then I go back into the New Testament for my New Testament reading. But yeah, and every time I'm reading it and I'm listening to it, I think, wow, there's so much in here. I just want to spend the rest of the day just studying this one chapter, but then life happens. But yeah.
It's funny how different passages hit you different ways at different times, you know, even whether you're reading it or listening to it, sometimes something just hits me and I'm like, I don't remember ever hearing this before. Like, is that really in the Bible? And then I go look it up. I'm like, sure enough, it is. But somehow the Spirit works on us in different ways at different times, you know?
Yeah. And it impacts me. You know, we just read that one verse where it says, already you are clean because of the word that I have spoken to you. And I feel that. Even if I don't get a new insight, just hearing the word of God and reading the word of God, it does something. It cleanses my spirit. It impacts me at a deep level. So, okay.
Cool.
So here's a couple insights about the word. Because to abide in the word, I think, first of all, we need to read it. I don't know how to say it any simpler. Let's try that one more time. To abide in the word, we need to know it. We need to read it. Way back in Deuteronomy, there's a long passage, 3 verses, and most of us only know the last line of it because Jesus quotes this last line in the beginning of his ministry. And here it is. This is Moses. The whole commandment that I command you today is you shall be careful to do, that you may live and multiply and go in and possess the land that Yahweh swore to give to your fathers. And you shall remember the whole way that Yahweh your God has led you these 40 years in the wilderness, that he might humble you, testing you to know what was in your heart, whether you would keep his commandments or not. And he humbled you and let you hunger and fed you with manna, which you did not know, nor did your fathers know, that he might make you know that man does not live by bread alone, but man lives by every word that comes from the mouth of Yahweh. So that's Deuteronomy 8. You can see why I love Deuteronomy, but it puts it in the context because Matthew 4:4, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God. Matthew, this is right in the beginning of Jesus' ministry. This is the fourth chapter of Matthew, beginning of the New Testament, and he gives us this insight. But you really need the whole context because he said he humbled you and fed you with manna. First, he let you hunger, and then he provided the manna. And the point was so that you might know that you don't live just by bread, but you live by every word that comes from the mouth of God. So you want to meditate on something. Meditate on that one verse today. Man lives by every word. And that's one reason I rarely read commentaries. Rarely. In fact, I can't even remember the last time I consulted a commentary. But because I want to read God's word. And that concept that we live by every word, that's one of the reasons I read the whole Bible every year, because I want to make sure that I know every word. In the last year, I have been going deeper into words by studying, and you don't have to know the Greek and the Hebrew anymore. There's so many resources, they explain it to you. All you have to do is just use the resources, but looking up the meaning of each word. So when I did my book on come into his presence, I found out that come into his presence meant come before him face to face. And it's the same expression in Hebrew that's used when it says, seek you my face in Psalm 27. If my people who are called by my name shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face, same expression. So coming into his presence, seeking his face, these are all the same words. So I've been going deeper because man doesn't live by bread alone, but by every word. Okay, you got that?
Yep.
Have I made that one? I don't want to overkill it, but and you have to know the word before you can go deeper into the word. But there's aspects, I think, of Jesus that we don't see until we know the whole scripture. Jesus himself says in John 5:39, you search the scriptures because you think that in them you have eternal life. And it is they that bear witness about me. Wow. So all of scripture is pointing to Jesus. All of scripture is pointing to Jesus, and they're bearing witness about Jesus. I've mentioned it, but I'm not ready to teach it yet because I'm still researching and digging into it, but I felt like God has led me more and more to look at the tabernacle and to look at the temple because I'm seeing more about Jesus the more I study that, because the tabernacle points to Jesus. And I'm seeing Jesus as outside the door saying, come unto me. And I'm seeing Jesus as the way into the presence of God by offering our sacrifice. And it says in Hebrews that he broke down the partition in his flesh. So Jesus, that was his, one of his primary purposes was to restore us to the Father. But we have the Father, you might say, in the Holy of Holies, and Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life into the Holy of Holies. And so the more I'm studying even this Old Testament, you might say, concept, it turns out I'm seeing Jesus. So scriptures point to Jesus. Every word of scripture is powerful and is pointing us to Jesus. Boy, I'm getting going here and I can see the time is running away. So let me just read one more here. This is one that I'll bet you, a box of peaches, that you know this scripture.
Let me guess.
2 Timothy 3:16.
Yes. All scripture is God-breathed and useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness.
You know the 17th?
I actually didn't memorize that part, but I have it in front of me because I figured you might get to this one. So, so that the servant of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work.
Okay.
I didn't read the first part, though. I just rattled that off.
Okay. So my box of peaches bet is safe. Otherwise, I was going to have to go online and see if I can ship you some. Interestingly, read the 15th verse since you've got it open. Oh, wait, 14. Start with 14. Okay. And this is Paul talking to Timothy.
But as for you, continue in what you have learned and have become convinced of, because you know those from whom you learned it, and how from infancy you have known the Holy Scriptures, which are able to make you wise for salvation through faith in Christ Jesus. All scripture is God-breathed and useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness, etc. Yeah.
I mean, 16 and 17 are wonderful.
Yeah.
But what was a revelation to me was from childhood, and we know that Timothy came to Christ through his mom and his grandmom. They're the ones that shared the gospel with him. But Paul knew this, and Paul says, you know, you continue in what you know, knowing from whom you learned it, and from childhood, from infancy, you have been acquainted with the sacred writings, which are able to make you wise for salvation through faith in Christ Jesus, because Paul knows the scripture points to Jesus, and the scriptures are what make you wise through faith in Christ Jesus. That passage is one of the reasons that I wanted to have family devotions in our home. I'm very limited as a dad, more so than I ever believed. You know, when you first have kids, you think, wow, you know, I can shape these kids. I can train them. I can teach them and all this kind of stuff. Pretty soon you find out these are little individuals that have their own identity, their own personality, their own makeup, and you can influence them, but you certainly can't get in there and do any really significant changing. But I thought, yeah, but God's word can, because the scriptures are able to make you wise for salvation through faith in Christ Jesus. So when you read through the Bible, know that the scriptures, these are pointing to Christ. These are laying the foundation for faith in Christ. These are eternal words. And with the rest of it, what you read is, it's breathed out by God. It's inspired. It's profitable. And if you get really good at it, you will be complete, equipped for every good work. Think about that. You and I have everything we need right in God's word. And all these challenges that are coming upon us in our culture, in the world around us, if we will be rooted and grounded in God's word and abiding in his word, we're going to be equipped and complete for every good work. We're going to see Jesus more. We're going to be bearing more fruit for him. I really believe that we're coming into darker times than we've experienced up to this point. Sorry, folks. Yesterday, I was out walking the dogs and my neighbor, really good guy, and he said, we were talking about how this ridiculous world that we live in right now, because anytime you get a runny nose now, you don't say, oh, I have a cold. You wonder if you're dying of COVID, right?
Yep.
Somebody posted on Facebook, I wonder if there'll ever be another flu season or it'll just be a different variant. Yeah. You know, no, really.
Yeah.
And we've got most of the world running around in fear. And a lot of my people that I know, they just say, I can't wait till it gets back to normal. I don't see it happening. I would wish it would get back to normal, but I don't see it happening. In fact, I have people now coming right up to me and asking me, are you vaccinated? Are you this? And one person going through the checkout line yesterday at the supermarket, she says, be careful. Don't get too close to this other woman who was checking out. And I said, okay. You know, I stepped back. And then as she left, she goes, yeah, a minute ago, I thought there was going to be a fight on aisle 8 because this woman was freaking because this man was too close to her. And I thought, really? And the checkout lady, she looks at me, she goes, people need to get a life. And I said, I never gave it up. I said, I've been ignoring this thing for the last year and a half, and I refuse to bow to it and live in fear. Okay?
Amen.
All right. So there you go. That's for free. But the point is that we are going through some tough times, and we're going to continue to go through tough times until this world bows before Jesus. So we want to be abiding in his word in a new way. We want to be bearing fruit and looking for opportunities to point people to Christ. Not fear, faith. I've seen that yard sign for a year and a half now. I wish I had one of those babies, but okay. So that's probably enough for today. Thank you, Father, for your word. Give us an appetite for it. Put something right down deep in us that we hunger and thirst for righteousness. Help us to love the Word of God. Help us to abide in the Word of God. Help us to read the Word of God. And as we read it, increase our faith and point us and reveal Jesus. Point us to your Son, because we know that all Scripture, inspired of God, profitable and wonderful, but it's bearing witness about Jesus. Help us to see Jesus as we read it. Help us to be more cognizant of his presence in God's word. But help us to have your eyes. You love the word. You inspired it. You commissioned it. And help us to have the same attitude towards the scriptures that you have. You have magnified above all things your name and your word. Help us to be careful to also magnify your name and your word. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. And that's our show for this week, folks. Thanks for joining us for the Building Faith Families podcast with Steve Demme. If you have a question for the show, email steve at spdemme@gmail.com. If you have a question for me, you can reach me at scott@unsocializedmedia.com. Thanks for joining us. Have a great week.